Hello and welcome to BW. We have with us for the roundtable on agriculture, Mr. R.G. Agarwal on my left. He's chairman, Dhanuka Agritech. Mr. Siraj Hussain, former agriculture secretary of Government of India. Following him is Professor Abhijit Sen, former member of Planning Commission and one of the main and leading economists of India. Then Ms. Neeraja Adidam, she is the Joint Secretary, Ministry of Agriculture. She is a nutrition expert, if I'm not wrong. She is handling the nutrition thing now. And following her is Professor Nilabja Ghosh. She represents one of the think tank of India, Institute of Economic Growth. So our topic of discussion basically revolve around how feasible is doubling farmers' income vision for India. So we'll start with none other than former Secretary of Agriculture, Mr. Siraj Hussain. Sir, can you please share your views? Is it feasible or not?
It was a good announcement made by the Prime Minister himself. And initially, there was no clarity whether the government wants to double the real income of farmers or only the nominal income of farmers. Because in any case, the nominal income doubles in about 6 to 7 years' time. The real problem is whether the real income of farmers can be doubled. So if we take the data, NSSO data for 2012-13, the income of farmers, average income of a farmer's household is about 78,000 rupees per year. Now, if we use 15-16 prices, it comes to about 97,000. So whether it can be doubled to about 1.93 lakhs a year by 2023, that is the question. So 2 years have already gone by, 16-17 and 17-18, and we did not see very high level of growth, agricultural GDP in these 2 years for a variety of reasons, including the depression of prices. Can we achieve about 12.3% growth from now to 2023? That is the question. 2023, can we now achieve 12.3% growth? To me, it looks very unlikely because it has never been achieved in India or anywhere else in the world. So even though it is a good objective, but extremely unlikely to be achieved.
I would like to request Mr. R.G. Agarwal. I mean, you represent the industry, sir.
Yes.
So can you please elaborate a bit on
what Mr. Siraj has said? That's right. But practically, we have to see the initiatives taken by government at present. Number one, in this budget, they announced that first time they are going to pay farmers cost plus 50% as minimum support price. This is the first time. Dr. Swaminathan committee report came in 2004, as I remember, but it was not implemented. And this is the first time this report is going to be implemented. So this way, if farmer get 50%, then number one, it is going to increase his income. Number two, marketing. Marketing is a very big issue. Today, farmer is not getting 2 rupees kilo for tomato, but in cities we are paying 20 rupees kilo, a big variation. Now the question comes, where this huge gap money is going in to the middleman, for which nobody is benefited. So the government initiative, and that is to be further implemented, that from farm to consumer, if it is done, then you see farmer will also get better price, consumer will get a reasonable price, then automatically consumer purchasing power will increase. Suppose the consumer takes half kilo tomato and 20 rupees. If it is 10 rupees, he may purchase 1 kilo. So his nutrition value will increase one side. Other side, farmer will also get good price. So it will help the Honorable Prime Minister's vision given in 2016 on 28th February Bareilly meeting, I think.
Yeah.
So it can be achieved. Even today, our exports are just $30 billion. And the target government is planning to reach it to $100 billion. That is possible if we make it India brand. Today we are exporting more than 1 lakh ton grapes. And in the world, they are one of the best grapes. So there are so many such crops we are exporting, but their export can be increased manifold. I was in Europe 15 days, in any of their super bazaar, no vegetable was below 400 rupees per kilo. And here it is 4 rupees kilo. So how much we can export? But we have to create. And today I was talking to one of the present Secretary of Agriculture. And I think on 38th, the meeting of the ambassadors are there, and government has decided to appoint in important countries one or two agriculture consulates to promote Indian agriculture, while other countries have appointed their consulates in India to promote their export. But so far our country has not taken this initiative, and now this is the first time our government is also going to appoint agriculture consulates in the important countries of the world. So they will promote made in India and export from India. If our export is increased, then the surplus problem which we are talking. Mm-hmm. And third is government policy is to promote storage. And there they are also giving support like for cold chain, cold storages, marketing, etc. also. So if this infrastructure create, the way roads are created, earlier farmers was not in position to reach to cities markets because his village was not connected to roads. But now the way roads are constructed, connectivity is increasing. Next is awareness among the farmers. That is also increasing. One side, if we compare Indian agriculture with China, our consolidated agriculture land is around 142 million hectare. China is 120 million hectare. Our average rainfall is plus 1000 mm. China is something 600 plus. But even then, their GDP is 3 times than our country. So from this data, I want to say that potential is there in our country also, but it is not harnessed. The new technology, for which, if I rightly remember, while presenting 2009 budget, the then Finance Minister, Mr. Chidambaram, has said in Parliament, our extension system has collapsed and we are looking for some alternate. But unfortunately, it was discussed, but nothing has been done in this regard. So now government is also talking to strengthen this extension system, and there are discussions to join private hands, something public-private partnership.
Seems that Mr. Agarwal is too much fascinated with PM's vision of doubling farmers' income. Professor Sen, what you have to say about that?
Well, I think the short answer to this is Siraj's answer, that it's extremely unlikely given where we are. On the other hand, I think Mr. Agarwal is also right that it's not an impossible dream. So if you want to think big, you can think big, and there is a possibility that not in the next 4 years, but that in a period of 6 years, it is possible to get something like a 7 years, something like a 10% growth in incomes rather than output, provided you do the things that I think essentially Mr. Agarwal was talking about, that is, have a fairly good growth in physical output. We achieved during the UPA about 4% growth there. So you need another 3% more than that, and the main source of that would have to be improved prices or improved returns to farmers on the output that they produce. I don't think it's impossible, but unfortunately, and this is where I think I probably disagree with Mr. Agarwal, I don't see any movement on either of these directions. I think we have done, actually, over the last 4 years, the overall output growth has been, well, for the first 2 years, mainly because of drought, it was zero, roughly. The next 2 years have been around 6 to 7%. So in a 4 year period, that works out to below 2% per annum. And on the prices side, they've actually gone down, not gone up. So obviously, for the next 2 years, to achieve anything in the next 2 years will be frankly impossible. And in terms of the direction which Mr. Agarwal is speaking, they're all correct. They've all been tried. This present government is also trying to do it. But I don't see anything which is a distinctive break from what has been done in the past. And unfortunately, I think there are several things which have happened, not necessarily because of the central government, but not a lot of things which have happened which makes me think that things are not only worse than they used to be in terms of policy on the ground, but the direction is that it's going to remain that way. And I'll tell you one main reason for that. The main reason for that is the 14th Finance Commission, of which I was a member. We gave a large amount of money to the states. As a result, the central government cut back on its expenditure and expected states to pick up their expenditures. Some states simply didn't, so that they got the cut on the central side and there was very little on the other side. Other states did spend more, but once you break down that spending, much of it is on things, and a very large chunk of it is on things like loan waivers, which is not going to add to future incomes. It's a palliative today, but it's not going to add to future incomes. And given that, I think it's always desirable to set your aim high, but it's even more desirable to actually make it happen. And I think plus on the first and a huge negative on the second.
See, the government is actually planning to do things on the ground and making entire transformative systems look very good. It appears very good from outside, but all the economists in their own manner, they just oppose it. I don't know what the terms are, reality, how they represent themselves. The numbers can be played very much and they can be manipulated also. But still, being a government representative, do you really think?
Yeah, as a part of the government, we are the soldiers of the policy implementation on the ground. So we certainly believe that we can increase the income of the farmers by 2022 or maybe whatever. But government has already taken initiatives. See, if you want to increase the income of the farmers, there are two, three areas where you need to look into. One is decrease the input costs, then take up productivity enhancement measures, and then markets, as my predecessor already said, and then MSPs. So first thing, how do you reduce the input costs? Two, three initiatives the government, after Honorable Prime Minister has declared that we should double the farmers' income, we have initiated the soil health card scheme, which is soil, as everybody knows, is the main source where you can have the production increase. So that, I think, earlier was also there, but it was in bits and pieces. In a national level, we had it, and in first cycle we could cover 11 crore farmers. Second cycle we have already initiated, and now there is increased awareness among the farmers. We are getting studies also done through different agencies. We have come to National Productivity Council. It has done a study. Manage has done a study. They said yes, there is an increase in awareness. And then there is 8 to 10% of increase in production, reduce in costs wherever there is farmers adopted soil health cards. Yes, there is lot much to do in that direction, but it is an initial step. It is very good and taken up very nicely. Second initiative I could say is organic farming, which is picking up, which is no chemical, because most of the farmers, the inputs are mostly towards
I hope Mr. Agarwal won't be in that much of a agreement with you.
Fertilizers and pesticides.
No, I don't agree.
So I'm giving you the policies which are taken up, and zero budget natural farming, which is picking up on many states. Even state government like Andhra has taken up and it declared its whole farming would be converted to zero budget farming by 4-5 years, and Himachal is taking up. We are also doing on 2 lakh hectares. So on the reduction of cost front and productivity, yes, we have already done integrated farming systems and diversification to horticulture, vegetable cultivation. If you see really on the ground, some of the young tech graduates which were working in Bangalore, places like Bangalore for, you know, as software engineers, we have seen examples where people have come back and doing the agriculture. They have adopted that, you know, poly house cultivation of these vegetables and fruits and taking it as a business models. So if you can see it as an agribusiness, so farmer should be treated as an entrepreneur, agriculture should be seen as agri-entrepreneurship, then we can certainly enhance the product, the income of the farmers. And third thing is, as rightly said, markets is very, very important. Wherever you go, farmer is not, his capacity is not up to the mark to do the marketing. So there should be somebody, some we need to make the linkages where markets are linked to the farmers. Even in the field, farmers say, whatever you want to do, जो भी प्रोड्यूस करना है हम कर लेंगे बट आप हमें मार्केट से जोड़ दीजिएगा विच इज़ अ क्लियर क्लियर कट मैसेज फ्रॉम द फार्मर्स सो बेस्ड ऑन दैट यू मस्ट हैव नोन इन दिस अनाउंसमेंट बजट अनाउंसमेंट्स व्हाट वी आर सेइंग एफपीओस स्ट्रेंथनिंग ऑफ द एफपीओस इज़ वन ऑफ द थिंग्स वी आर सेइंग ऑल आर स्कीम्स मोस्ट ऑफ आर स्कीम लाइक राष्ट्रीय कृषि विकास योजना वी हैव you know, this mission, organic value chain development, horticulture mission, we are now focusing on FPO development. Not only the numbers, the capacity increase of the FPOs also. And the rural markets, there is emphasis on rural hearts, development of rural hearts in this budget. So that way, and MSP also, as he rightly said. So we are taking right steps in the right direction. We would certainly work towards it. And how much we could, and on top of it, all these agriculture is a state subject, all said and done. So unless we have the, cooperation of the states, it would become difficult, but we are also working towards it. And I would certainly think that we can achieve it.
Is this really feasible to speak about MSPs nowadays? Have they lost their relevance?
Actually, talking about this income first, whatever I have seen Niti Aayog's calculation, I think I would agree with Mr. Siraj Hussain on this. But then again, it is no harm thinking big. I wouldn't take it too literally, even if it takes some more time. But I have some more questions than that nominal versus real. Are we talking about agricultural only crop income? Or the farmers can get involved in other, you know, associated, we have to create employment in the agro processing, in some amount of processing can be done in the rural areas, some amount of input supplies can be created there, then IT opens up a huge scope as it opened up in the urban sector in the 1990s. And then drought year and good year. That's another question. What is the doubling of income? In a drought year, it comes down. Do we talk about the resilience of farming also? And similar to drought year is also this trade liberalization and the prices which you were talking about. If the prices go down, like some years back we saw, last year I think, the MSP of all the pulses went down. The market prices went down much below the MSPs. So does MSP take care of that? What about the price stabilization fund? Is that the way to go around? These are some of the questions that strikes me. It's not just, I don't much believe in that average income figure which NSS gives or something. I would look at the distribution also. Because across the state, it is not the same thing. Some regions have good rainfall, higher productivity, income may double there. Many regions may be left out. So we cannot be complacent about this. So this distribution is very important. And in some cases, we have seen in that there are negative incomes. The people only farm for some subsistence. So what does it mean for doubling income there? We have to look at the whole distribution. And I think I would agree that a lot of right initiatives have been taken. But maybe we should find more direction in the economic policy. That's my view.
Siraji, I was actually going through a data of Farm Bureau of USA. So US Farm Bureau is basically, it's a very old agency now. A century old maybe. They've got a very decent kind of a data that United States of America, a usual farmer, a marginal one, not actually the marginal in our case, but the marginal is like somebody who's owning like 100 acres or like that. He was earning around 35 cents over $1 some 30 years back. And now the reality is that he's somewhere earning around 13 cents over $1. So it's falling down everywhere. And they are the biggest exporters.
Actually, the if you see 30 years FAO data, you find that the farm prices have remained stagnant. And that is one problem which is there globally in the agriculture sector. And the stress is being felt not only in India, but also in very highly developed countries like the US, even the US. However, coming back to the income from sources other than cropping, you see one very important decision of the government which has harmed the cause of increasing the farmers' income is the ban or restrictions imposed by the Ministry of Environment and Forest in 2017 on trading of animals. So the government said that the buyer has to give a certificate while buying an animal that it will not be used for slaughtering. Trading was not allowed within 50 kilometers of international borders, etc. Of course, now many of these restrictions have been withdrawn. The Supreme Court had also stated, but the damage has been done. Professor Sen would know, and this will be proved when the data for farmers' income is actually released by NSSO. You will find that income from milk has already gone down. Milk prices used to rise in every summer. This year the milk prices have been reduced even by Amul. And the prices of animals have crashed. We visited Bihar recently. We went to Samastipur and other areas, Darbhanga, etc. There are no buyers for animals. There are no buyers for cows, out of milk cows. So you see, it is correct, the government thinking is correct, that the farmer's income has to be supplemented by sources other than farming. Now, what are these sources? Beekeeping, fisheries, milk, meat, leather. Now, because of this fear of violence, the trading in animals has gone down. How it will have an impact on farmers' income, we will see when the data is actually released. Now, one last point coming to exports. The Ministry of Commerce has issued a draft policy in which the target of exports is not $100 billion, Agarwal sahab, the target is $60 billion. Right now, our exports have been on an average about $30 billion. What will happen to exports over the next 5 or 10 years? You see, one of our major items of exports is non-basmati rice. About 6 to 7 million tons of non-basmati rice, 3 to 4 million tons of basmati rice. So if we assume that basmati rice exports will continue, the threat of reducing exports of non-basmati rice is very real, because ultimately a day will come when the government of India and the state governments of Punjab will be forced to impose restrictions on cultivation of paddy in these two states, which means the production of non-basmati rice, sir, will have to get reduced. So that will mean that if you have to continue to assure food security to the nation, then the productivity in Bihar, West Bengal, eastern states has to go up. So which means, Agarwal sahab, that one of our major items of export, non-basmati rice, may not continue at this level. The second major item of export is buffalo meat, $4 billion a year. That is also under threat because of all these restrictions, fear of violence, etc. So these two items are gone. So which means we have to look for other items. It is correct that fresh fruits and vegetables have good scope. For that, we need very high quality value chains. Mm-hmm. For that, the government did well to increase the budget of Ministry of Food Processing. They doubled it. But we had advocated at least 5-time increase. You know, the demand for cold chain and other modern facilities is so high. You know, investors want that the government should supplement their investment by giving subsidies. That is not being adequately met, especially in eastern India. So to sum it up, there are enormous challenges in the agriculture sector. Doubling of farmers' income, in my view, is not going to come by 2022-23. However, it is a good aim to have. Also, lastly, it will be very difficult to double the income of farmers of Punjab, sir. It is already very high. I wrote an article in Mint in which I said that it may be easier to double the income of farmers in Bihar, Jharkhand, West Bengal, where it is low. And easily you can increase 15-20% income by sprucing up your procurement of wheat and rice in Bihar. Sir, even this year, when we have reached 35 million tons of procurement of wheat, the procurement in Bihar is very low. So the governance in eastern India in agriculture, food processing sector has to substantially improve if we have to meet these targets.
Do you really think that whatever Punjab has faced is all because of the agrochemical industry?
It is totally misconception. You you see, the only Nobel Prize winner in agriculture, Dr. Norman Borlaug, what he said, at that time the world population was $6.6 billion, and he said that you the total organic of the world, even then you can't feed more than 4 billion population, and what will happen to 2.6 billion population? First, this is a big question, and we have to decide, are we going to leave these 2.6 billion people to die? First thing is to feed them. Regarding organic, you compare with US, Europe, Japan, Australia, they are very rich countries. If they could have managed with organic, then definitely these countries would have been the first to stop the chemicals and fertilizer. Today our pesticide consumption is just 0.600 gram per hectare, while countries like China, who are having three times more GDP than us, they use 13 kilograms per hectare. Regarding fertilizer use, they use more than double fertilizer than our country. I don't mean that we should use blindly pesticides or fertilizer. I fully agree that fertilizer use should be judiciously based on soil health card. Similarly for pesticides, they are to be used judiciously as per need, not blindly. So this organic, if we want to go organic, we can go organic. If you are sick, you have got allopathy, you have got homeopathy, you have got Ayurveda, you have got Unani, you have the option to go, but for which people are going today? So we have to see practically what is possible, what is not possible. It is all theoretical about organic. Is some word myth or some fashion?
Is this the like same way where doubling farmer's vision is also?
No. It is 100% possible, sir. Doubling farmer's income, maybe 1 year, 2 year, this side or that side. The initiative the present government is taking. Compare when farmer will get, instead of 2 rupees kilo or 10 rupees kilo for tomato, for onion every year we see, when onion crop come it is 5 rupees kilo, but after 3 months it is 50 rupees kilo. So if farmers are trained that they should not sell at 5 rupees kilo, they should store and government finance them, because government is financing them. Because industrialists, when they borrow, they invest the money in their business and multiply their money. But unfortunately, in spite of government funding 11 lakh crore to farmers, their position is not improving, because they have not invested that money in agriculture, in business. They have spent the money on marriages, making home, building, taking cars. If you don't invest the money on your business, then it is not going.
I still remember, Mr. Mahatma Gandhi's quotation about the industrialist. They are the trustees of the poor in India. Right. That was his trusteeship philosophy. He actually initiated with that. So, how much is the interest of industry to actually create more wealth than creating money or profit?
Today, you see.
And can you come up with some kind of an idea with the government to invest in coal chains?
Yes. Government should come, what Mr. Siraj Hussain said, that their budget is not enough. But if you see, the budget in agriculture has been doubled than earlier government, and you can't expect this government will put total budget on agriculture. Apart from budget, the point which one came, the agriculture should be taken as entrepreneur, and farmer we have to develop as entrepreneurship by education. Aaj 11 lakh crore rupiya, it's a big amount. If it is invested in agriculture and business, then all scenario will change. Unfortunately, we have given the loan to farmers, but has not trained him how this money should be utilized. And in one of the seminar, and even today I am going to hear, India Today is having full day seminar. Yeah. Our present Secretary of Agriculture said in that seminar what to talk last year. Doubling of the farmer's income, if we make water available to him, then his income will be 2.5 times. Okay. And this government has made, if you see Honorable Prime Minister's vision, even on 5th June in Vigyan Bhavan, when it was for plastic environment, he said per drop more top, everywhere is focusing on water conservation. And my company started this in 2005 by giving a slogan, Khet ka pani khet mein, gaon ka pani gaon mein. Our Honorable Prime Minister last Sunday on Niti Aayog meeting talked about that double digit growth, and he said that growth can come from agriculture and mining. Last year I wrote an article in India Today where I said that what to talk of 7.5% growth, our agriculture growth can be more than 10%. This I was not talking today, I written this article last year, published in India Today. So it is possible. We have to identify the lacunas, and if we say that this government do or remove all the lacunas in one day, I don't think it will be possible for any government. We have to understand what is the achievement at present, what is the achievement in the past. I don't say every step in this government is also right. Regarding extension, we are lacking. Still lot is to be done about farmers' education. Some educated people, yes, they are coming, they are not coming like ordinary farmer. They are coming as entrepreneurs. There are farmers who are minting money in agriculture. I will like to give the example of pomegranate farmers. They are making 5 lakh rupees per acre, and now that is spreading. Similarly for milk. Earlier we were talking, major focus was on cereals. Today our GDP, which was $100 billion in 1970, it was, as per FAO, was $360 billion, if I rightly remember 2015. Mr. Neeraja, you can, Madam Neeraja, you can correct me if I am right. So from 1970 we have come to 367 from 100, and in this now 1/3 contribution is from cereals, 1/3 is contribution from horticulture, and 1/3 is from dairy and poultry and fishing. So that way our shift of income is from cereal to other side. As it was discussed, that farmer cannot get the double income from only agriculture. That is very right. I like to quote example. Last week we were in Punjab, in Hoshiarpur. We did 3 meetings, where in one meeting Honorable Gajendra Singh Ji Shekhawat was there. There Mr. Vijay Sapla locally, and Mrs. Krishna Raj was there. In Hoshiarpur, apple orchards. Mm-hmm. And you know in apple how much money can be earned. Yeah. So this is the horticulture, vegetable. You see earlier what was the milk availability. Today per person, what is the milk availability? Milk has changed the life of the farmer. It is one of the source, even if due to drought, whatever way, if agriculture fails, at least he will have such income he can survive if he is having some 1 or 2 milking animal. So we have to see not in isolation. We have to see the positivity, what is happening, where is the potential, and wherever we lacking. Regarding biopesticides or organic farming, Sikkim, where it is organic farming and farmers are trying, they are not having their production. Rice, they are not in position to make their own production. They are importing rice from Bengal, and their ginger crop, it is destroying due to sheet blight, and they are smuggling pesticide from other countries. And in the name of biopesticide which are available in the market, out of those 90% pesticides are laced with chemical pesticides. Government has got a division, All India Residue Network, where they draw around 16,000 samples of various food items every year. And as per their analysis, which is available on the website, in the regular chemical farming, in 2% samples, pesticide above MRL was found. While in organic samples, 35% samples were having pesticide residue. If this type of organic we are talking, I'm sorry, we can't support this type of organic in name of organic cheating of the farmers. So we want organic. Someone 5-star hotel is very good, very comfortable, very nice. But how many people can afford? We have to think for an ordinary traveler also, that he should be provided a suitable, reasonable place to stay. So we have to think for everybody. If one can afford 500 rupees kilo rice, today which is the price in Japan, whatever way organic, let him do. But you can't ignore ordinary poor fellow ki he should not get even the food.
Professor Sen, is it like three people selling 1 kg of rice in 200 rupees per kg and somehow making it available to the consumer, the end consumer? That price can be distributed among 20 people. It's better than 2 rupees per kg selling to somebody else. I mean, it's like three farmers are selling something in 200 rupees rather than 200 farmers selling something in 2 rupees. So it's the premium pricing for organic. That is the result of diversification.
See, look here, I mean, there are too many things coming in at the same time. As far as the organic part is concerned, I don't want to get into it because obviously tempers get frayed on this matter. So I'll keep off the organic. I think the only point that I would make there is that, yes, provided that people are convinced that it is pesticides free, it is purely organic, they are willing to pay a higher price. But if that breaks down, nobody will be willing to pay that higher price, if that confidence breaks down. On the other hand, I think the point that you are making, I'll take it in another way, which is there is a number of farmers, how much they produce, the same output or the same sales being done by more or less. I think I'll just pull that in a totally different direction, which is that the income per farmer will ultimately also depend upon the number of farmers there are. And I think we are already witnessing from around the mid-2000s a decline in the absolute number of people in agriculture. And that's a damn good thing. Unfortunately, that seems to also have suffered a little bit of a hiccup in the last 2 or 3 years, simply because not enough jobs are being created elsewhere for, you know, the construction thing having broken down. That was the main source of jobs from outside agriculture. And those incomes are very important for any doubling, just as what Siraj talked about, which is that the fastest growing part of agriculture is, in fact, the perishable, whether it's horticulture or livestock. Within that, livestock is even faster than horticulture. And within livestock, milk, we've done fairly well, but over the last 10 or 15 years, the one which is growing really fast was meat. And I think we've actually hit a block there as well. Now, much of these, just like as in the case of organic farming, are up against strong belief systems. And I think so long as our strong belief systems go, either on people working in agriculture or how we conduct ourselves, then agriculture will have problems which need not be there. I consider some of these problems to be quite serious. And as far as the issue about getting people more incomes by the same output being shared by fewer people, the best way of doing that is really to process, to add value to the output that is being produced, and take some of the workers who are directly in the primary stage into the processing stage. Now, this is precisely where the farmers, producer organizations and things come in. And that's something which had started. It had a good momentum. The momentum continues, but I don't see any acceleration. And one of the reasons for that is that there has been the movement on legal issues on these are all under the Companies Act, on the taxation side, on what exactly is how does the FPO come along are all creating, they still work, but they haven't sort of got off the ground as they were supposed to. And finally, I think one must realize that all of these things cannot be done by, say, having visions from Delhi. We have to share that vision with the states, and it is the states which must design their own systems, and for the same objective, you'll have to actually design slightly differently at the level of each, forget states, at each district or even probably even below. And what you need for that is to start off at the central level, the mindset which says, we are out of it, we'll help those who do the best thing. And that is something which again I find is relatively missing in a government which actually has basic theme seems to be ki sab kuch, there are good ideas which come from the top.
It's not sabka saath, sabka, that is fine.
The idea is not ki bhai, the good ideas come from the bottom, and that we actually just make it grow better. We help it. Hum vikas aur sabka nahi karwana chahte.
Isn't it a kind of excuse for the government? I mean, it's always the state subject. Agriculture is always the state subject. So central government always has this kind of excuse with them.
No, not at all. It's not an excuse. As sir has rightly said, micro planning or the planning at the bottom level is much more important. Thinking that, good ideas only come at center is never the idea that central government envisages, as at least on agriculture department part, I can say, sir. And you know it, sir, RKVY, one of the ideas that you have done it, Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, which actually develops the ideas at the state level. Like state has to come up with innovative ideas and the gaps where they can plug in, for their own agriculture development. So that way, most of the schemes, they give leeway to the states to come up with their own innovations. So that part is taken care, sir. Even the new guidelines coming up for many of the schemes, we give loosely the policy guidelines. The states are coming up with their own thing. We are giving that kind of liberty to the state. Then we never take that, as an excuse that it is everything has to be done by the state. As I said, rightly I said that states have to implement it, but we are there to oversee it and get it done in the field also. It is happening also because most of the schemes, as I said about soil health card, e-NAM, we have already 585 mandis on board now.
But there are thousands to go.
We'll buy 2020-22, so we would do that 1,000, and more than 1 crore farmers are there with that, and initially there were hiccups. See, when a new initiative is there, there will always be negative things that may come up, but now we have done 37,000 crores of business through this e-NAM. So I think that's one of the initiative which says about, marketing that needs to be done. Second thing I want to say about, there is one discussion on Eastern India, developing Eastern India, which is, we have a program for that also, bringing green revolution in Eastern India to increase the productivity of that region. And then second thing is, I would say the diversification part, bringing green revolution in, the agroforestry, bamboo mission. Some of the policy changes you must be knowing, like tree felling was banned on many of the species. Now most of the tree species have come out of this forest act, and bamboo is no more forestry. So now we are encouraging farmers to go for, apart from these things, these allied activities like, agroforestry and bamboo mission. And convergence, as rightly said, agriculture department cannot do all the things at a time. Like, so we have MSME, we have MOFPI, many of these ministries where they have the niche expertise. So there is always convergence required from different ministries to achieve the goals of value addition, marketing. Maybe entrepreneurial development. So we are looking into it. That's what I said. Some of the policies earlier used to be productivity oriented because we were measured on those numbers only. Kitna production hua, kya hua. Now we are saying in terms of income, then comes your value addition marketing part. So we are taking care of it. we are on the job. So I think I feel we would get it. On organic front, I would like to clarify that organic, there are some niche. We never should be compromising on the food security. I don't believe in that, as you rightly said. But there are certain areas where traditionally the fertilizer is not reaching there. Like maybe some hilly areas, some dry land areas. Maybe those areas we are also targeting those areas only. And sitting in that seat, I know it because I look at organic farming. Although I was not a believer earlier, now I see there is lot of enthusiasm among all quarters. Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister says about organic revolution. Farmers are in favor of saying organics because of the premium price they are getting at some places. Consumers also looking at it with a pinch of salt that they want to have the quality. FSSAI has come up with right guidelines, regulations for organic products. Now it has come up from July onwards. It should be either certified by PGS, Participatory Guarantee System, or third party certification. So see, regulations are there in any case, like in any adulteration. If food adulteration is there, you cannot, unless you, the regulators are in place, you cannot control it. The organic is also in the same way. I think since we are talking about doubling of farmer income or increasing the farmer's income, this could be one of the ways, I feel. And I think we can reach it.
Professor Ghosh, your final words about that.
Concept of farmer's income, and put some good words, of credit to the government, that this income is not just about some income from some crops. Of course, there are other sources of income, but this is something good that which we were expecting for a long time, that the discourse has shifted from higher production to the rights of farmer to live a good citizen's life. That is farmer's welcome, and that doesn't just depend on the income that is earned from the crops. It depends on the access to health, education, electricity, for women farmers, on to cooking gas. And then this marketing is there, which this government is trying, but of course there are several constraints to this national agricultural market. And one of that is this quality checking, how to assay the quality, and because we are used to going and checking the product ourselves. So we need strong, we can create more employment out of it, to make some regulatory bodies. I mean, I don't mean government bodies, maybe there can be some organizations who can be trustworthy. See, in other sectors, we are going for online trading. We are buying things, so we trust. So there's a big scope there. And creating this supply chain, all this is there. But somewhere I find the direction of the economic policy not very clear. To us and maybe to the states and the farmers, there's a lot of things to do. Because as we discussed this MSP, whether it is a very good intention to ensure that farmers get at least 50% of the cost as surplus. But will the MSP do it? That's a big question. Because we are not living in the 1970s now. We have to create the right incentive to produce the right products that are in demand and in the right way. We have to use less of manpower, less of land, less of water to produce more now. And for that, we have to create more jobs. And I think the best would be jobs around agriculture, whether it is allied sector or some bit of processing or regulatory activities or IT, whatever. And we need to have this precision agriculture where we need these sprinklers and micro irrigation, so the water actually reaches the plant when and where it needs it. Fertilizer also, same thing. And this, another good thing is they have done this direct benefit transfer, but how it is working, I don't know. There are several issues in it. Like the fertilizer, they are doing it on pilot basis, which the fertilizer industries are taking care of. Now there are many problems there, like in marketing, I said. So, but one thing is this, whatever the MSP policy they take, it should not be distortionary in today's times. It has to be across the board. We have to think of farmers who are not producing huge surplus, eastern region where procurement is not so common. So how are we going to do it? This deficiency payment, will it work there? So these have to be thought of. And when we think about exports, we have to, you know, there is a huge scope of promoting our products. This is, you know, quality, not just quantity, also quality. And if you speak about this organic farming, true, it organic farming is not the tool for food security. But of course, we can. It's not just organic and non-organic. We can reduce chemicals in other products also. I don't know if there is any protocol for giving some certification on that. But we can, you know, hard sell these organic products in the world market.
Site Management Bill 2017 is actually a pretty good initiative by the government. Can we sum up, Siraj Saab? I actually ask you to give the final words.
Before I start summing up, let me say something which concerns Professor Abhijit Sen. One of the expectations from the new government was that it will reduce the number of people, percentage of people who are eligible for this very cheap food grain. You know, under the National Food Security Act, which was enacted. So everybody was thinking that this percentage will come down from 60% to some number. You know, a high-level committee under Mr. Shanta Kumar, ex-chief minister of Himachal Pradesh, recommended that it should at least be brought down to 40%, so that you save some money. You see, right now the amount which is being spent on food subsidy alone is 1,70,000 crores. So you don't have savings for investments. As far as this question of increase in budget is concerned, you know, a lot of it is the transfer of crop loan scheme from Ministry of Finance to Ministry of Agriculture. So if you see the schemes of Ministry of Agriculture, the crop insurance scheme, of course, has seen a very high increase. Now, it is a very good objective to have to increase the income of farmers. However, we have to realize that if you increase the production too much, that production has to be absorbed by the economy. That can be absorbed either by increase in income. Renu Kohli wrote an article yesterday, a very nice article, saying that the prices have depressed not because India has become a very large and stable producer of commodities, but because the demand has gone down. So the demand has to increase, and secondly, the food processing has to increase, and thirdly, the exports have to increase. Then only the increase in production of various agricultural commodities can be absorbed. Otherwise, you will have depression in prices, which you are having right now, which is very damaging for farmers and the agricultural economy as well.
So for the final piece, we can come to a conclusion that it may take a bit of more time, but by 2022, it is very much achievable, a doubling farmers' income. It may take maybe 2-3 more years, but maybe it's a possibility.
Farmers' income will double.
So finally, it will double for sure. Thanks a lot. Thanks to the esteemed panel to be with us here on the show. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you for inviting us. Thank you very much.